My name is Colin Moores. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Politics and Public Administration that has been putting this on since Phyllis's death in 1988. I knew Phyllis only briefly for about a year, but I was honored to be a member of the union that she helped to found, which was then called the Canadian Union of Educational Workers, later to be called CUPE. And I'm going to invite, before I introduce tonight's speaker, I'm going to invite Don Elder from CUPE 3904 to say a few words about Phyllis Clarke.
Thank you very much. Phyllis Clarke was born in 1924 and she died March 21st, 1988, having lived a life devoted to socialism, trade unionism, feminism, community activism, and teaching. Quite a dossier. She served on the Toronto Public Library Board and played an important part in making libraries more committed to Canadian literature and multicultural and multilingual literature. The Toronto Reference Library has her, is holding her papers now. She was active in labor struggles from the 1940s onward. She was a founding member of the Graduate Assistance Association, which became the Canadian Union of Educational Workers, CUEW, in 1980, and then was amalgamated with the Canadian Union of Public Employees, CUPE, in 1995. Phyllis, a longtime member of the Communist Party, earned her PhD in 1977 with research entitled Application of Marxist Thought to Canada and co-edited a biography of Tim Buck. She joined the Department of Politics in Ryerson, in 1977 and helped define its commitment to intellectual inquiry and social justice. It's been my pleasure for the past several years to represent CUPE 3904 and the labor movement at the Phyllis Clarke Lecture. We support any activity in the name of a person who is reported to believe that, and I quote, the free development of each is the condition for the free development of all. Thank you.
We're very honored to have tonight with us Costas Lapavitsas, who teaches at the School of Oriental and African Studies, University of London. His research spans political economy, money, finance, the Japanese economy, history of economic thought and history, and the contemporary world economy. For the last little while, perhaps not surprisingly, he's been focused on the Eurozone crisis, and he's part of a group of researchers associated with the research on money and finance at SOAS, and his longer-term research interests include financialization of capitalism, crisis, and its manifold implications for society today. He's a frequent commentator. I've seen him on the BBC at least a few times on the situation in the Eurozone, Greece in particular. He's a frequent contributor to the international and Greek press. His most recent books are Profiting Without Producing, Crisis in the Eurozone, and Financialization in Crisis. He's going to speak to us tonight on the Systemic Crisis of Financialization from 2000 to the present. Please welcome Costas Lapavitsas.
It's a great pleasure for me to be here, and I'd like to thank Ryerson University for the invitation. It's an honor to give this lecture and come this way to do it and to interact with you. I have been dealing with issues of finance and transformation of contemporary capitalism for a long time, so I will present to you some ideas and conclusions about the current state of capitalism. I will do so in a Greek accent. cultivated in London. So it would be a strange mixture of British tones with Greek delivery. I hope we will communicate. If I get too excited and start speaking too fast, my Greek will come out. Please slow me down. But we probably will be alright. So without further ado, let me get on with the substance of the presentation. So in effect, I will discuss what I think is a key aspect of contemporary capitalism, its financialization, and what to do about it. Now, no matter what we think about contemporary capitalism, I think we will all agree, no matter what position we take on it, we will all agree that finance has got an extraordinary presence within it at the moment. I don't think there's any doubt at all about it. It's a stylized fact. Whatever you turn, whichever mature country you look at, finance appears to have an extraordinary presence within these mature economies in terms of size relative to the rest of the economy, in terms of penetration into all kinds of economic and social activities and various aspects of social and political life even, and of course in terms of influence, which is where the political life comes into it. The financial sector appears to have become enormously influential in shaping all kinds of policies in contemporary capitalism. So I don't think there's any doubt that finance is extraordinarily powerful, and I don't think most people would be surprised if we said that contemporary mature capitalism has become financialized. All of us would have some kind of intuitive understanding of this. The real question is, what does it actually mean? What more precise content can we give to the word financialization other than the general stuff about the rise of finance? Now, there are many approaches to this. There are many currents of thought on this. I'm glad to report that there's a term and the basic understanding of it really comes from Marxist political economy in one way or another, and from my reading of the literature, essentially it comes from the first use of it that I can identify is basically Sweezy and the Mountain View current. Other people have used it in different ways, but essentially it's a Marxist concept that others have used from other traditions. I don't have time to go over the many different uses and meanings associated with it. I'll tell you what mine is, which I developed in this new book of mine, Profiting Without Producing. So I believe that financialization is a historical transformation of capitalism. It's a structural change. It's a pivot, really. It's, if you like to think in those terms, an era. Actually, I would make bold and say that when we think of how contemporary capitalism has developed, globalization, which is a much used term and I use it myself, captures less accurately than financialization what has actually happened. To me, financialization captures better what has happened to contemporary capitalism the last 3 to 4 decades. How then are we to identify this historical transformation, this period? Well, like all great changes of this type, we need a mixture of approaches. We need to do it partly in theory. In other words, we need to find real economic and social processes which will explain to us why this change has taken place. And we need to do it partly in terms of institutions and history. We need to locate it, in other words, as middle-range theory. Some elements of what has been happening in capitalist production and the capitalist economy, and some elements of what has been happening to capitalist institutions and to the history of the period. So let me start with the first. In my view, and this is again what I argue in this book of mine, the basic elements at the level of theory that capture financialization three. There are three fundamental tendencies occurring at the molecular level of capitalist accumulation. The first has to do with commercial and industrial enterprises, the productive hub of capitalism. I am, in many ways, an old-fashioned Marxist when it comes to these things. I would like to start with the productive sector, I like to start with production, I like to start with where value is created and produced. And to me, financialization is in good measure located and rooted in what has been happening in the productive sector, in commercial and industrial and commercial enterprises, not financial enterprises. It might sound a paradox, but it isn't. To identify financialization, we've got to start with non-financial enterprises. So what has been happening there? What has been happening there is a twofold process. Big business, large monopoly capitals, big multinationals, whatever you're going to call them, have gradually become more and more independent of banks, or less dependent on banks. Space has opened up between big commercial and industrial enterprises and banks. The reason is that large enterprises have become more self-sufficient when it comes to financing investment. They can finance their investment very heavily from retained profits. They retain profits, and that is on a net basis how they finance their investment. Of course, they still use banks. That's not an issue. They still interact with banks, but they don't depend on banks for additional finance to finance investment. Retained profits will do. In fact, retained profits are so large that at the moment, large enterprises in the mature capitalist countries, the United States, the United Kingdom, Japan, and so on, are sitting on enormous amounts of cash which they're not investing. So what do they do with this cash? They play financial games. They financialize. So that's the twofold process that I mentioned. They become more independent of banks, less dependent on banks, and more capable of undertaking financial activity on all accounts. They have become finance-like to a certain extent. They have financialized. So financialization starts from the transformation of the industrial and commercial enterprise, the big business of capitalist world, in this way. The penetration of finance and financial activities into the world of the large commercial investment enterprise. That's the first thing. The second, and associated with the first, is of course the result of transformation of banks. Banks are also capitalist businesses, they are to make profits. And if there is space opening up between big industrial and commercial enterprises and banks, it means that banks can do proportionately less business with these big enterprises, and indeed we see that they lend less to them than they used to, and they have to seek other areas of profit making as a result. Banks have had to reinvent themselves, and they have reinvented themselves during the last 3 to 4 decades. Banks have turned towards making profit, not out of lending to business so much, of course they still do, but not out of lending to business so much as out of transacting in open financial markets. Dealing in financial assets, buying and selling, and facilitating the buying and selling of financial assets, and making a profit out of fees, commissions, and trading in these things, rather than straightforward collecting money and on lending it. That's the first major transformation of banks. At the same time, banks have begun to see profit in the realm of households. If the area of big business has become less profitable, less amenable to bank lending, then you've got to look elsewhere, and banks have begun to look for profits in the activities of households. And that is one of the most striking aspects of financialization, this turn of banks towards households, which brings me to the third fundamental tendency or trend, which has to do with households. Households in contemporary mature capitalism have been sucked into the formal financial system in an unprecedented way, like never before in the history of capitalism. We've had an integration and an absorption of working people even right down to the poorest layers of the working class, into the formal financial system. Household life and household activity has become financialized. And this financialization we can observe both on the side of debt, people have become hugely indebted, proportionately to their incomes and proportionately to the economy as a whole, gross domestic product. But also on the side of assets. People have also acquired more financial assets and hold more financial assets, which they are obliged to deal with, and that has to do with, of course, mostly their pensions, insurance, and so on, which has become a bigger part of household life. Now we might ask, why have households become financialized in this way? Why have they been sucked into the financial system in this way? The standard answer, and it's undoubtedly true to a certain extent, is that household income, real wages, have been stagnant for a very long time during this financialization period. In the United States, real wages, real incomes have been flat for more than three decades now. And that is undoubtedly an important part of the story. Debt being a way of supplementing consumption and so on. But that's not really all of it, or nearly, or most of it even. The financialization of households is a more complex process, and it's easy to see that when you think of what household debt is, as well as bringing household assets into the picture. Households don't borrow because they don't borrow like businesses. There is no household business to maintain. Households borrow because they've got a life to keep going, and the concerns of household life are often non-capitalistic. That basically everyday family concerns and so on. They have to do with housing, they have to do with education, they have to do with health, they have to do with the various needs of everyday life. Now, how have these needs been covered historically? Partly through public provision. There have been mechanisms of public provision covering some of these needs and allowing people to do the things that they need in everyday life. What we've witnessed the last 3 to 4 decades is a substitution of private for public provision. We've seen a retreat of public provision and the growth of private provision for housing, health, education, and so on. Financialization has to do with the mediation of this process by private finance. Private finance has emerged as the lever that has allowed private provision to substitute itself for public provision in all these areas, and therefore has allowed private banks or private financial institutions to make profit straight out of household income. It has made household income a field of financial profit making, which is remarkable for money in the history of capitalism. Now, not much about the economic fundamental processes of financialization, if you like, the roots of it, the molecular dimension when we look at capitalist accumulation and what it means for financialization. What about the institutional and historical dimensions of financialization? How are we to fit the fundamental process together with the broader picture of historical and institutional change? Well, I'm going to mention three key aspects of these of the institutional and historical framework within which financialization has taken place the last 4 decades. The first is key, and it has to do with the development of, if you like, the productive forces of capitalism during the last 4 decades. The last 4 decades have been an era and a period of introduction of massive new technology. In life, information technology and telecommunications technology. It has transformed many aspects of life. What it hasn't done is to solve the profitability problem of business in the real economy. Profitability remains problematic, and it hasn't solved the productivity problem of the real economy. Despite the introduction of these new technologies on a grand scale, productivity increase fails to be impressive. In fact, productivity rises rather slowly. That's one of the paradoxes and one of the key features of financialization. Because although productivity will not rise very fast compared to past periods in the history of capitalism, the introduction of new technology has allowed finance to transform itself. Financialization would have been impossible without the information technology and the telecommunications technology, which allows banks to do all these things across the world in split seconds. So that's the first institutional historical dimension. Second element in this institutional historical framework has to do with inequality. Financialization has been a period of profound inequality. We've seen a reversal of inequality trends in a historical sense. Inequality was very pronounced in most mature countries up to the Second World War, and then we see it declining rapidly for 2 to 3 decades. Once financialization sets in, inequality increases enormously, and at the moment is arguably at its highest level in the history of mature capitalism. So this has been a period of pronounced inequality. Inequality in terms of income. The top layers of the income distribution have creamed off all increases in productivity. There hasn't been much of an increase in productivity, but what there has been, it's been creamed off by the top 1% of the income distribution. And we've also seen functional inequality increasing, meaning inequality between capital and labor. Capital has basically triumphed over labor in terms of the share of output that goes to it in all mature countries. So this has been a period of profound inequality. There are many reasons for this inequality, but there's one thing that's key. Finance has been a key lever in allowing inequality to take place. As I will argue in a minute, financial mechanisms have been vital to allowing the rich to remunerate themselves and to distance themselves from the poor. Finance and financialization has been a key mechanism for the acceleration and exacerbation of inequality in the last 3 to 4 decades. So that's the second element of historical and institutional development that I want to mention. The third and last, which will allow me to discuss some things subsequently, has to do with regulation and deregulation. What has allowed financialization to happen and has benefited from it and has actually been strengthened by it is, of course, the process of market deregulation that we've witnessed the last 3 to 4 decades. And this market deregulation we've seen obtaining in the labor market, first and foremost, where the ability to hire and fire has become much greater for the employer, but also rights to work, rights of the workplace and so on. And second, we've seen deregulation becoming very pronounced in the realm of financial markets. That doesn't mean that there hasn't been regulation, as I would argue, too, some regulation too, but deregulation of what used to exist before, deregulation of various controls. So in those historical and institutional ways, financialization has benefited from these profound changes and actually added to them. Here we are then. This is a historical process that has roots in economic development, such as I've discussed, and it has been shaped by these institutional and historical transformations, also contributing to them. What can be said about the global, social, and ideological dimensions of that? What is the broader significance then of this transformation in terms of the world as a whole, in terms of social structure, and in terms of ideology? Let me start with the world as a whole. What does financialization mean for global structures of influence and power? I would argue that financialization is ushering in a new period of imperialism, fundamentally. It's a new range of hierarchical and power relations that have emerged in global markets and across the world economy, which in the last 10 to 15 years have taken a particularly strong and peculiar dimension seen for the first time in the history of capitalism. Mature countries have financialized, as I've indicated. They've transformed themselves and finance has become very, very powerful. In that context, mature countries have also been accelerating the export of capital. They've been sending liquid money capital abroad. They've actually been exporting this capital among themselves, but the last 15 years, they've been exporting increasing amounts to developing countries. Foreign direct investment, portfolio flows, these things have sustained themselves at very high levels throughout the last 15 years or so. But the world is always a more complex place than that. This has definitely been taking place, but that's not the only trend that has been occurring in the last 15 years. Because the other thing that has happened in the last 15 years is that developing countries that have been receiving these flows have also been forced to accumulate reserves, reserves of US dollars, basically. Vast reserves of US dollars in order to continue participating in the world market and receiving these flows of FDI for direct investment and these flows of portfolio money coming across. Now, how do you accumulate US dollars? You have to buy US state financial assets, treasury bills, our various bonds and instruments of indebtedness of the US state. So to accumulate these dollars, developing countries have to buy US government instruments of indebtedness. Well, that means the money is going back to the United States. That means that the states of developing countries are lending money back to the United States. If you net it out, if you net the financial flows from investing capitalists to receiving capitalists in developing countries and developing countries states sending money to the United States, if you net all these flows out, the net result is a flow of capital up here. Developing countries have actually been financing mature countries on a net basis. It's a bizarre result, but that's what has been happening. On a net basis, capital is flowing from developing countries into the mature countries. Because developing countries have been keeping vast reserves. These reserves pay developing countries very little. The United States pays next to nothing on its state indebtedness instruments. It's a very costly way of sending capital to the United States, very costly way of running your economy, but it's more than that. Because as developing countries have been sending these monies to the United States, and assuming this financing position relative to the world hegemon, as they've been doing that, they've had to transform their own financial systems to be able to hold these vast reserves. And what have they done? They've developed financial markets themselves. So what we see in country after country in the developing world, Turkey, Brazil, Korea, Mexico, and so on, is a huge growth of financial markets, domestic financial markets, partly led and catalyzed by the sending of money abroad to the United States and the holding of reserves. The domestic banks in these countries have had a field day and using the new markets, the new instruments, have expanded lending. And what you see in a range of countries of this level of development is the growth of financialization in astonishing ways, which also involving lending to households, private indebtedness, banks playing all kinds of games in the domestic market, and so on. This is, I would say, subordinate financialization. Derivative financialization, deriving from the financialization of mature countries. It's the reproduction of power relations, hierarchical relations, in the particular, peculiar ways of the current period. The world economy is financializing, but not in the same way. The developing countries are financializing in ways that are dependent on mature countries. So that's the first thing I would say about the global dimension.